from the very beginning, my desire on this trip was to bring a couple of my great friends together who had never even met. They're both just as happy if you fill your tag as if they filled theirs, which I think can create a really special adventure.
Say the trip really started when Mark came out on a rifle hunt, and Mark was hooked, I think, on mule deer hunting in the high country. And I said, well, if you like this, you should try it with a bow.
So I spent a lot of time in the field hunting with Mark from, you know, the Northwest Territories, Montana. We traveled to New Zealand together to hunt and fish, but I'd never hunted big velvet mule deer bucks in the mountains. Especially in an environment like Colorado where you're hunting from 11 to 14,000 feet.
Bobby killed like the biggest mule deer I've ever seen the year before, so I basically invited myself to go archery hunting the next year. It was just a window of opportunity where Adam was gonna be able to go hunting as well, so we just looked at it as like two of like, you know, my best friends that we could put together in that situation, and it was just, it seemed like it'd be a really good opportunity to get just a fun, loving crew together in a great place.
And it was on. I mean, it was on.
Things are getting lined out. Everything looks like it's finally planned. I get a phone call and find out that I've drawn a Nevada archery elk tag, which is supposed to take 14 years. And for some reason I drew it on year 5. So I'm really excited, but then I'm like, oh no, I've got to call Mark and tell him, what am I gonna do?
I got a call from Bobby one day and he was like, I've got good news and I've got bad news. He said, I drew the best, like one of the best elk tags in Nevada.
You know, kind of a once in a lifetime elk tag, not a lot of non-residents draw, and it takes a lot of points.
And I was like, okay, well, what's bad news? And he's like, it's the exact same dates as our trip in Colorado. And immediately I was like, man, you got to turn the tag back in. Like, you got to turn the, I mean, get rid of that tag and you know, let's really focus on this deer hunt. You know, this is going to be a really fun trip.
And then when I found out if I turned it back in, it wasn't an automatic draw the following year. I would be back in the system and it would probably take me another 10 years.
It kind of changed the way that we had to go about Colorado. It was gonna basically cut off the last week of the season. At the same time, I mean, if you get that kind of luck, comes knocking on the door, you gotta take advantage of it. So we just said, cool. Mark and I were gonna go with Bobby and try and help him on the Nevada hunt for elk.
I had always heard Adam was just a really intense, very hardworking hunter, but also very talented. He was the best of the best. I mean, he was one of the youngest, if not the youngest, to ever kill the Grand Slam with a bow and arrow. I mean, that's pretty incredible in and of itself. I just didn't think this would be how I first met Adam, like, hey, you're gonna meet this guy and spend 35 days with him.
What I knew about Bobby before I met him was that he was a really good hunter. I knew he hunted whitetails primarily in the Midwest. And that takes a lot of discipline and a lot of skill. And I think that passion just spread to go hunt in the mountains for sheep and moose and mule deer. And I just had heard that he's a predator and didn't disappoint.
I mean, this deer is like...
That deer is amazing.
Look at his body. He's a big, mature deer, too. This guy's definitely going to be right at the 200-inch mark.
This one?
Yeah. He's tremendous, yeah.
How are we going to decide who goes first and how we break that up?
Whatever you guys want to do, I don't care.
It'd be fun to rotate, like, on stalks. That'd be sweet.
There's a million things that can happen. I don't really care who kills what or who goes first, so we're all on the same team anyways, right?
Yeah.
So would you assume with as many deer that were there?
Or you come up from
this plan for tomorrow. We got a plan for tomorrow night.
Let's keep rocking. Let's go find some big deer.
So here's where the trail takes off right here.
Great back forks, really good mass, great width.
I think somebody in this group will have an opportunity at a really, really big buck.
He's in a bad spot for continued life.
Day before opening day here in Colorado, I think I'm definitely looking at the biggest buck I've seen in a week of scouting. So that's a good thing.
It's kind of like the kiss of death sometimes too, when you find a great animal way before the season. Are they gonna stay in the unit? Are they gonna walk up and over the mountain and you're never gonna see them again? Nothing's guaranteed in hunting. And I think in scouting, we were happy to find some deer, but also we had no guarantees on whether or not we were gonna be able to actually, you know, be able to hunt them.
Opening morning. No better place to be than right here. Hunt big mule deer. And we're just trying to relocate a couple really big bucks that we saw yesterday.
We have this big group of bucks. Like, there's five bucks that we would easily shoot, two giants that, you know, were our target deer. And the problem was is that where we found them, they were on a ridgeline that was the border between a unit we could hunt and a unit we couldn't hunt. And they went up over the ridge opening morning. So that immediately set us like backpedaling.
Our first spot fell through, and our second spot, we had another great buck that we found before the season. He was by himself.
I mean, that first morning, I don't know, Mark looked at me and I looked at Adam. I'm like, you've never shot a high country mule deer with your bow? Let's go.
We're sneaking in there at first light and he just kind of for no reason got up out of his bed and just went right up and over into the other unit.
If it doesn't happen opening day, it gets like incrementally harder every single day. You bump a deer once, it's harder to get on them a second time.
These guys both got to within 15 yards of him in like 9 foot tall willows.
And eventually I think he caught to a little wind in there and just blew out. We just gotta keep checking on him. We'll find him.
Mules on three?
Yells on three.
1, 2, 3.
Mules!
After a few days and we hadn't gotten it done, and suddenly the sightings of the bucks were way down. So it started to become concerning, but it's not like it changed our mood or we panicked. I mean, that's just hunting. You know, every night we just, okay, let's pull the maps out. Let's find a new spot.
We're looking around and we find this buck laying there, you know, just a kind of a dream buck, heavy and old and dark horned and by himself and big old body on him in a pretty killable spot.
I think Mark's gonna hang back and spot. Bobby's number one shooter. I'm backing him up. That's a pretty good guy to have backing you up. Trying to help the guys by flagging.
He's kind of lowering his head, you know, keeping the brim of the hat over his eyes and just like staring. Like so intently, and a big thunderclap like came through and just
boom, and he stood up.
And Bobby's at full draw.
I was completely calm, very relaxed, pulled back, put the bubble on him, steadied it, released, and I saw the arrow just going right at him.
Look hit?
Oh. Yeah, I thought I saw the arrow going perfectly right at him.
And then he ran out of there and just like nothing happened.
I didn't, yeah.
I didn't see anything. that lightning cracked and he kind of like three quarters stood. And I mean, 39 yards. And I was right on it. I saw the air going right at him.
Right in that hole?
In that hole.
It's just the worst feeling in the world. And everybody who's hunted has been there, and I've been there. And so you have a lot of empathy, right? You're like, you just know what he's going through, and it's just like the lowest of lows, right?
You know, the fact that you're part of this team and they're sacrificing their time up to bat and their days scouting and you're trying to get this done. I mean, it was something I told Mark the other night. I still have nightmares of blowing that shot.
Big, giant 190 kind of buck, big sticker off his back, beautiful. We looked, and then when I walked over to the bed, I stood in the bed and Adam stood where I shot and he went 44 yards. So I'll go home and check the target, but I'm shooting a little heavier air this year, but I was 6 yards off on where I'd set my sight. The rangefinder must have been picking up the willows. It happens. It's extremely frustrating. These guys are going to a new spot. I gotta go take care of little work things. So I'll be back out in a day and a half, hopefully in a day and a half or two, they've got a couple bucks down. At least one would be nice.
Well, Seacat made a sweet spot on a bunch of bucks. I think there's 11 in total. Why not take a crack at them? So we're gonna make a run on them. It's about 5:45, so we gotta bust a move, but gonna go have some fun, I think.
You wanna just like walk this way?
I think we walk the timber and down and around and just basically skyline ourselves right there.
You're in a perfect spot.
The wind must have just pushed down a little bit and the two bucks that we were after spooked out that night.
They kind of went around the mountain and yeah, that sucked.
Well,
what do you think?
What do you think?
Nailed us as soon as we came off that cliff. And then you start to think, okay, these animals that grow big are smart. They grow big for a reason. And we might be able to see them and stalk them, but we might not be able to close a deal on them because they are, you know, kind of experts at staying alive.
Whoa.
Tomorrow. Always another chance.
That next morning, woke up and it was foggy and nasty and we figured the deer would have been blown out. And I was just asleep and Adam's like, hey, I can see those bucks there in the exact same spot.
The way that we were running things, like I would get to go hunt on the stock, then Mark, then Bobby, we would cycle through and he could see I was kind of foaming at the mouth because, you know, it was just like later in the hunt and I was ready for some action.
He's all alone right now.
Round two, ding ding. It's gonna happen in 35 minutes or not at all.
He was like, oh, why don't you just go for it? And I was like, are you sure? And he was like, yep. And I was like, okay. And I grabbed my bow and there was like a Adam-shaped dust cloud heading up the mountain.
Adam's like 60 yards above this buck. It's bedded. It's gonna be a tough spot. Adam's not gonna be able to see the deer, I don't think, until he stands up, so. He's relying a lot on us to get the playing right.
Mark's kind of really adamantly, you know, hey, keep going, you know, he's pointing me down. And I'm kind of looking and I'm going, you know, obviously there's something I can't see. So I keep sneaking along and then all of a sudden, like, poof, there they are, like the velvet tips of a buck. I got a chance.
Well, we had like a hail and rainstorm come in, and we got the buck up out of his bed. Adam was able to sneak down a little farther. He's got to just be getting soaked.
Just like that, it quit. He stood up and then he was kind of feeding and...
I mean, I can remember just being like watching, just so anxious, like looking at it, just like, oh my gosh, this is happening. Like right now, he's gonna do it.
Come on, buddy.
Hands moving to the bow. The buck bedded.
Your heart rate's going boom, 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 picking up and pounding and pounding, pounding. And then he beds back down and you're like,
oh boy. We could be here for a while now.
Just like that, he stood right up and it was perfect.
He's about to draw. He's drawing. Full draw. Shot. Deer's not doing good at all. Deer stopped. Great exit wound. He made a great shot.
It was cool. It was really neat to watch that. You know, you're like watching it all through binos and spotting scopes and switching back and forth. It worked out perfectly.
Finally.
For it to happen and come together, it's like what you dream about.
Oh, it was this huge sense of relief. Sometimes it just takes one. You have that opening day energy again and like, hey, let's get back out there.
We had opportunities and stalks on tremendous mule deer. I mean, in most places in the country, you'd never see bucks like that.
The mule deer part.
But on to the next thing.
Oh yeah, that next thing.
Deep down, I mean, my passion, my number one thing that I love to hunt is elk.
It was like a fresh start. We had gone from like this amazing hunt in Colorado, diving into like a premier unit in Nevada with elk that are gonna be rutting.
I just wanna work as hard as I can for Bobby because we've kind of shot ourselves in the foot a little bit by cramming in this Colorado hunt and then going right to Nevada, but one great hunt to another is a good problem to have.
Day one, new country. We don't know a whole lot. Then some internet. Research, a bunch of phone calls. Unfortunately, just didn't have a chance to get down and scout this area. So we're going high as we can, and just trying to locate a good bull. It's a beautiful area. We all read the magazines and we play on the internet, and you get one of these covenant tags and you expect that there's gonna be 350 to 400 inch bulls just everywhere. And they're gonna be screaming and they're gonna bugle all day long and they're never gonna stop. Well, that did not happen. We covered a lot of miles, and for the first 4 days, I don't know that I heard a bull bugle. Adam and I did pass up one pretty nice bull at a water hole one night, and I'm not a big water hole guy. I mean, I grew up sitting in tree stands and ground blinds, which I love hunting whitetails, but man, the beauty of elk hunting is to run and gun to me, covering miles and calling them in. And so we were just putting on the miles and we just weren't seeing elk.
Ran into a guide who was like, hey, we've been hunting this giant bull. Like he could be 390, he could be 410. I'm not sure, you know, like that's a huge elk. Okay, I am on this. I am gonna cover this mountain until I find that. Even if it's not my tag, I feel like I'm part of it.
Meanwhile, Mark's our eyes and ears in a different place and trying to cover as much ground as we possibly can and hunt efficiently because we're getting down to the wire. I mean, there's 3 days left in the season.
We were running trail cameras, we were splitting up, we were hiking, we were scouting.
We're living off of backpacking meals. Everything's covered in dust. It was hard, but it's also fun. That's like what you live for.
One night I was up on a real high peak and miles, probably 4 miles away, I could see four bulls. And they looked to be big mature bulls, but they were just so far. So, you know, the next day Adam and I went to that area.
It socked in.
So we're like, here we go, we finally find elk and we can't even hunt them.
We're telling stories and having fun, and Bobby says, oh, why not? Let's just go out and maybe I'll bugle and see if we can hear anything. And right away, answer. You know, bull answers below and another one in the distance.
The clouds lifted, and when they lifted, it just switched. It just, the rut kicked off. Suddenly, it was a whole different world. There were bulls screaming everywhere. I mean, it was just one of those 30 minutes as good as elk hunting can be.
And I'm back cow calling, kind of making a disturbance and having elk run around and cows call back to me and just kind of trying to keep focus of the elk herd off of Bobby if they know he's there.
It's just the dream hunt that you dream about when you, as an elk hunter. I mean, just all of a sudden I look behind and he's putting his head, trying to just come up under the bushes. I see these huge fronts and he bugles right in my face at 12 yards and I'm at full draw.
What happened?
Well, as you guys saw, I had like four cows around me. The little calf came running 3-4 yards and she bellied back. And so I just kept calling and it seemed like they wanted to go this way down to the left. So I don't know if you noticed, I ran behind you guys. Next thing you know, I look to my right, here comes 7 cows.
15. Coming up this way?
No, coming down to me. I'm underneath them now. I came all the way around below. And they're coming down, wind's perfect. And then I hear something behind me. Here comes a calf behind me. She catches my wind and runs. And again, I go on a mouth call. Next thing you know, I look over in the brush and I just see horns coming. And it's so thick in there. You can't really... And all I know is I'm like, okay, he's the herd bull. He's with a bunch of cows. I see this big horns coming through. I come to full draw, toom, drill him right behind the shoulder.
It's just fun when you just let one rip. Like close range. He was doing the deal. You know, I just saw his horns like this. I was like, that's got to be a pig. I just pulled back. And the way our hunt's been going, I was like, he looks really good.
Let's just see what happens.
Yeah. Let's see how that feels. I'm just going to pull back and see how that feels.
I ran over.
So my streak stays alive, I've never missed a bull. But I've missed a deer now.
Go, buddy.
Cool. Heavy bases.
That's a great bull, man. That's super cool.
Woo! It was a cool moment. I got to relive that excitement right away with them. I would have loved to have been there, you know, and it just didn't work out that way, but that's just the way hunting goes.
You know, the hike outs are, those are the best hikes you'll ever do. I mean, they're painful, you got a bunch of weight on your back, but you know, you smile the entire time. You kind of know it's over, all the hard work's paid off.
It's kind of the fairy tale ending. I mean, it ended just the way that I know Bobby wanted it to end. I know Mark wanted it to end. I wanted it to end. It feels good to just, yep, we did it, boys.
All the funny things that happen, all the hardships, the misses, the successes, you have that to look back on. I think that part of it was really rewarding because we got to be there and we got to have those experiences together.
the guys you've shared a camp with or a backcountry experience with. I mean, those friendships are just at another level. When you've been put in situations where really life or death sometimes, and those people had your back and you look out for one another, you can't replicate those relationships. You can't fake those relationships. I mean, those come from experiences in the outdoors.